Every now and then during my research for the Just Have a Think channel, a technology headline comes along that really grabs my attention. A perfect example is a recent claim from a group of Australian researchers that they've achieved a conversion efficiency of 30.6% from a single junction perovskite solar cell. Now, if you're not all that interested in the minutiae of these things, you might be thinking, well, that sounds plausible, so what's the big deal? You might even be thinking, what's perovskite and why is it relevant? Which is a fair question, and one we'll come back to a bit later on. The thing is, though, 30.6% conversion efficiency for an apparently real-world, production-ready solar cell is significantly higher than anything we've seen on the market before. The very best perovskite solar cells available today are achieving conversion efficiencies of around 26%, which is already considered to be a cutting-edge breakthrough for this material. To jump from there up to more than 30% would be quite the technological leap. So is this apparent breakthrough the real deal, or just another lab curiosity destined never to make it out of the press release? Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. So here's the story. A small company called Halo Cell Energy, working with researchers at Queensland University of Technology in Australia, has been playing around with another well-publicised technological game-changer, graphene. What they were searching for were ways to incorporate graphene into the conductive layers of a perovskite cell to improve performance and reduce cost. To do that, they teamed up with a material supplier called First Graphene. Graphene, as I'm sure you know, is a single atom thick sheet of carbon that, as well as being incredibly strong, also has the enviable quality of being extremely electrically conductive. So the idea here was to insert a very thin, functionalised graphene layer into a perovskite solar cell stack with the goal of moving electrons around more efficiently, reducing resistive losses, and crucially, replacing the expensive conductors like gold and silver that are used in existing solar cells. So what do they mean by functionalised then? Well, the precise details of that are a trade secret for now, but what I can tell you is that Halo Cell have found a way to enhance the conductivity of the graphene by adding what they refer to as localized metal nanoparticles. The company reckons that that not only represents a technological leap forward for the solar photovoltaic industry, but by replacing gold and silver, they say this configuration could also slash material costs of perovskite PV film by as much as 80%. Those are certainly some pretty bold claims. And as with all bold claims, it's important to delve into the fine print, isn't it? We'll do exactly that in a minute. But it's worth reminding ourselves of how perovskite fits into the mix and how it compares to traditional silicon cells, because it's been a year or so since we last took a look. So it's all about the wavelengths of sunlight that can be captured and used within a solar cell. Some semiconductor materials can absorb a very wide range of wavelengths, which means a large amount of all available sunlight is being utilised, which is great. But those materials typically only deliver a tiny electrical voltage, which effectively makes the solar panel useless. There are alternative semiconductor materials that have properties that result in much higher, more usable voltage, but those materials typically only capture a very small range of wavelengths, which means most of the sun's energy gets wasted, all of which is extremely frustrating for solar PV developers. Back in the 60s, two physicists called William Shockley and Hans-Joachim Kaiser worked out that the semiconductor material with the optimum balance of wavelength capture and voltage was silicon, and that the maximum theoretical efficiency of a single junction photovoltaic cell was just over 30%. But the efficiency of a silicon solar cell drops off quite a lot if there are defects or blemishes in the material, so the cells have to be subjected to extremely high temperatures to get those defects out. And for reasons of physics that are well outside the scope of this video, the photons of light that hit the electrons in the silicon need a bit of extra help from things called phonons to provide enough energy to liberate those electrons and help them jump up into a state where they can be harvested off into an electrical circuit. Getting randomly hit by a photon and a phonon is much less likely than just getting hit by one or the other on its own. So to increase the chances of that happening, the silicon layer has to be made quite thick. Now, for reasons of physics, which again we won't delve into here, perovskites don't need that extra phonon to get their electrons moving, which means they can be manufactured as very thin films. Perovskites can also be chemically manipulated or tuned to capture different wavelengths of light to silicon, which means they can be adapted for a wide range of different light sources, and they can be applied as a thin layer on top of silicon wafers, creating so-called tandem or multi-junction cells. The resulting cell can then absorb a far wider spectrum of light while maintaining a good working voltage and, in theory, overcoming that Shockley-Kaiser limit of roughly 30% efficiency. That revelation started a whole field of tandem research that's still going on today. So what's the scoop here then? I mean, how has the HaloCell team managed such an apparent jump in performance? Well, that's a very good question, and one that I posed to the team themselves during a recent web call. The answer lies in the application that the cell has been designed for. You see, not all solar cells are made for panels that sit outside on our roofs. Some are calibrated to work indoors in low light conditions. HaloCell explained that testing at institutions like the US National Renewable Energy Laboratory, or NREL, and at the well-known Fraunhofer Institute in Germany, primarily focuses on a standard known as AM1.5G. So what does that mean? Well, AM stands for air mass, and the 1.5 number represents the strength of sunlight after passing through 1.5 times the thickness of the atmosphere. That corresponds roughly to the sun at about 48 degrees above the horizon, which is typical of mid-latitude regions. And the G stands for global, which takes into account both direct sunlight and diffuse scattered light from the sky. So this is clearly a standard designed to achieve uniform testing for solar panels that will spend their operational lifetime outside. So when you see the phrase cell efficiency under standard test conditions, or STC, that generally means the cell was measured at 25 degrees Celsius under AM 1.5G illumination at 1000 watts per square meter. Now, that is not the relevant test for very small solar cells designed to replace the batteries that are currently used in billions of tiny devices that run our modern world, discreetly providing constant energy in the background without most of us even realizing they're there. We're talking about things like TV remotes, calculators, toys, lights, e-readers, and myriad products that provide control systems for so-called Internet of Things, or IoT devices. The standard for that category of use is called, wait for it, IEC TS 62607 Part 7-2 Nano-Enabled Photovoltaics Device Evaluation Methods for Indoor Light. So the IEC is the International Electrotechnical Commission. Their test doesn't look at the sun's spectrum, but instead focuses on how you actually measure and report the electrical output of perovskite solar cells under ambient light conditions. And this is how we start to see those apparently impossibly high efficiencies. The Shockley-Kaiser limit that I mentioned earlier is derived assuming standard outdoor full-spectrum sunlight conditions, which closely correlate to the AM 1.5G test we just looked at. Efficiency is limited by nature in this instance. In other words, lots of the incoming photons have either more energy than a semiconductor can deal with, in which case it's wasted as heat, or less energy than is required to bump electrons out of the semiconductor, in which case the photons are not absorbed at all. But indoor LED lights very efficiently emit photons that are mostly in a part of the visible range that just happens to align very closely with the so-called band gap of HaloCell's tuned ambient perovskite module. So what's that then? Well, essentially, the band gap represents the amount of energy needed to nudge an electron from where it normally sits in something called the valence band up into a more excited state in what's known as the conduction band. If you want to capture power from an indoor LED light, then you tune the perovskite to a band gap of 1.5 to 1.6 electron volts. That means almost every photon that arrives can be harvested, and there's very little wasted excess energy. And because the input power of an LED light is so well matched to the tuned perovskite solar cell, it can achieve an apparently very high power conversion efficiency under those indoor test conditions. Now, I don't want to send you completely to sleep here, so I won't go through every parameter of the IEC test. Suffice to say, it's designed to prevent cherry-picking best results or providing misleading numbers from laboratories. Now, here's where it all gets a bit technical, so brace yourselves. HaloCell's representatives explained that they actually ran three distinct tests at the Queensland University of Technology. The first was with a single junction perovskite cell using a simple conductive layer of graphene without that metal nanoparticle functionalisation that I mentioned earlier. That cell managed a 17% efficiency. Then they tested the same cell configuration, but with the expensive traditional gold conductive layer. That cell actually achieved a pretty amazing 40.3% efficiency. Last but not least, they tried their functionalised graphene setup, which is where the 30.6% efficiency number comes from. Now you might think, well, just go for gold then. But don't forget, the functionalised graphene conductive layer still offers world-leading efficiency, but with a massive reduction in material costs, and crucially, a significant reduction in production cost as well, because unlike gold conductor layers, which have to be produced using something called vacuum-processed sheet-to-sheet production, the functionalised graphene layer cells can be run through roll-to-roll machines that have far lower running costs. That's a pretty compelling argument for making the change. But what about the biggest Achilles heel for perovskites, which is their notorious tendency to degrade rapidly in heat, moisture, and UV light? Well, the HaloCell team told me that a big part of overcoming that challenge has been to chemically tune the perovskite material itself to make it more inherently robust. On top of that, though, they've also been working closely with another technology partner to develop a protective cell encapsulation method based on a proprietary nanofilm system that, at this stage, again, I can't tell you much about because it's, you know, proprietary. What I can tell you is that by combining their tuned perovskite and functionalised graphene cell with that nanofilm encapsulation system, their device exceeded the IEC's damp heat test by a factor of 3. That test subjects samples to 85 degrees Celsius of heat at 85% humidity. It's not a UV test though, because again, this particular device is not designed for external use. HaloCell's primary focus, at least for the moment anyway, is manufacturing thin film perovskite photovoltaics using roll-to-roll techniques. But the tunability of perovskites that I mentioned earlier means it can essentially be made to work in any application, indoors or outdoors, and across a very wide light spectrum. In fact, the HaloCell team explained that they already have a single junction perovskite cell with a gold conductive layer tuned for full sunlight that's achieved a 25.8% efficiency, which is already very close to the world record of just over 26% for that kind of configuration. And they're working hard to get their functionalised graphene technology into that product as well. And as an added bonus, especially for those of us living up here in the much cloudier regions like Northern Europe, perovskite cells work better than silicon cells in the early morning and late afternoon and have a far superior cloudy day performance. Plus, perovskites use far less energy to produce and, according to HaloCell, are 98% recyclable, which means their overall carbon footprint is significantly smaller as well. Developers aren't restricted to single perovskite cells or silicon perovskite tandem cells either. All perovskite multi-junction cells are also being pursued, with each perovskite layer tuned to absorb a slightly different part of the light spectrum. Those devices can up the potential real-world production efficiency percentage towards the high 30s and beyond. That work is still very much at the lab stage right now, but it shows the enormous potential for this cheap, lightweight, flexible material beyond what's been achieved today. So it looks like perovskite is really starting to achieve its moment in the sun, with manufacturers like HaloCell developing and manufacturing perovskite photovoltaics for a broad spectrum of applications, not only encompassing billions of tiny domestic and industrial devices, but also with their high-efficiency perovskites tuned for full sunlight, crossing over into powering drones and even satellite PV modules. And we may yet see this technology on our rooftops in the coming years. HaloCell Energy reckons these latest breakthroughs are laying the groundwork for powerful, lightweight and ultra-low-cost full utility-scale photovoltaics, all of which suggests that an industry that has already seen costs fall by about 90% over the past decade still has plenty more incremental improvements to offer. As always, leave your thoughts in the comments section below. But that's it for this week. Please do like and subscribe if you haven't already done so. That simple click really does make a massive difference to the child's growth. So if you feel I've earned it this week, then you'll have my eternal gratitude. You can also directly support my work by joining the fabulous group of individuals over at patreon.com/justeverthink, who literally help me keep the lights on around here and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. Most important of all though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.